Lawyers of Reddit, what was the best gotcha moment you ever experienced? Lady got into a minor fender bender with a truck in a casino parking lot. She backed out of a spot into him. My guy said she parked and went inside the casino for a few hours. At her deposition, she testified that she was so hurt she went right home into a hospital. I asked if she was a frequent visitor of casino, and if she had a rewards card. She was happy to tell me she did and she had gold status, and showed me the card. I subpoenaed her rewards card's records, and it showed she was playing slots for hours after the accident. My client's house burned down from an explosion in the fuel oil tank used to heat the house. It was clearly the oil maintenance company's fault, but his homeowner's insurance, from a very reputable company, still refused to pay out, citing a ridiculous technicality in his policy. Essentially, the policy covered damage caused by the oil heater, but they claimed that it was the storage tank that exploded and wasn't part of what was covered. So they deny his claim, which was about 1.2 million, and then I get involved. During a deposition with the claims adjuster, I ask how she came to the conclusion that the storage tank was not a part, or at least connected to, the heater. She states that she relied on her expert witness who was an engineer. Little did she know I had already checked this person's background. He had zero engineering experience or education. As most of you might know, you don't get attorney's fees in most cases. However, when an insurance company denies your claim in bad faith, now you do. Her little admission cost the company about 500k in fees, on top of the original claim for 1.2 million. And this is why so many people try to screw insurance companies. Because they are right there, trying to screw you too. Plaintiff had an x-ray of an allegedly broken arm. It seemed off to me and the dates didn't make sense. I was in-house at an academic medical center. I looked at the case more closely and discovered the plaintiff was a x-ray tech at another hospital. After that, it was all over. I was trying to get a restraining order for a woman in DV court from her son's father. We are presenting testimony and she details a story where he grabbed her arm and slammed it on the tub, breaking her wrist. On cross, I asked the accused if he ever broke my client's wrist on purpose. His response freaked me out. I did. She was 9 months pregnant, about to smoke crack and wouldn't stop. I tried to grab her arm to get the pipe and protect my unborn son. Frick me. She left that detail out in her conversations with me. You are bad guy, but this does not mean you are bad guy. I had a former client file for bankruptcy and in connection with that case brought an action against his landlord for violating the automatic stay. In order to prove damages, he wanted to show he paid my firm for legal fees in connection with the landlord's pursuit of rent and violation of the stay. So this former client's bankruptcy lawyer serves me a subpoena to show up at the bankruptcy hearing. He didn't ask me any questions prior but just gave me the gist of what the objective was. That is, verify with the court the time I spent and the cost to his client. The bankruptcy attorney called his client, my former client, to the stand first. He asked him questions related to his hiring my firm to do this and that as it related to his landlord. Apparently that's not enough. The bankruptcy attorney wants me to verify these facts as well. I get put on the stand and I'm asked to verify the invoice. I first object to the question as a precaution since it may be a violation of attorney-client privilege to answer the question and to cover me for any claim by the bar or my former client. As predicted, the judge overrules and orders me to answer. I review the invoice answer. No, this is not my invoice. His attorney, I don't understand. This is your firm's logo and information, right? Me, yes. His attorney, and you provided these legal services, right? Me, number. A very confused attorney slowly started to put together, after a couple more follow-up questions, that this idiot client of ours had manufactured my invoice to prove his damages. Needless to say that I could have given his new attorney the heads up, but I wasn't going to help someone who had committed perjury to the court using my name. I had represented him in a completely different matter and this guy was trying to make some extra cash through this bankruptcy hearing. Two lessons. Tell your attorney everything and as an attorney, make sure your client feels comfortable to tell you everything. Cross-examining a custom home builder who had a lump sum contract, set price as opposed to cost plus, which means cost of the materials plus X percent as builder fee, with the homeowner, claimed he put 20% more labor materials in building the home than the contracted provided for and he was suing for these excess costs. was asking him about an email with my client negotiating the price of the construction, and he volunteers that he knew he couldn't build it for that price. My head snaps up, supervising partner's head snaps up, and opposing counsel goes pale. Dialogue was something like, "Me, you quoted X price? Builder, yes. Me, you knew you couldn't build it for that price? Builder, yes. Me, you knew the homeowner was relying on that quote? Builder, yes. Me, you knew homeowner wouldn't have signed contract without that representation? Builder, yes. Me, and you told homeowner's lender you could do it for X? Builder, yes. Me, and bank relied on that price and wouldn't have given loan if knew it was wrong? Builder, yes. This is textbook fraudulent inducement and he had no idea. Builder got poured out in the arbitration award and slapped builder with sizable punitive damages on top of it. 5 minutes of testimony sunk his case because he volunteered information without being prompted. Plaintiff alleged he was so injured in an auto accident that he couldn't work, do any regular activities, or pick up his young kids. He then posted on his public FB profile him doing the ice bucket challenge. If you're not familiar, he basically lifted a huge cooler filled with ice water over his head. His attorney had no idea he had posted it. Once heard about a man who got a doctor to do him a report for his compo claim. Can't bend, can't lit, can't run, etc. Problem was, he had a paternity suit ongoing at the same time. Got the same doctor to write a report for that case. No restrictions on mobility. Can't pick up the kid, play with him, etc. As you can guess, he, and the doctor, got caught. Perhaps not my best, but it was recent and pretty good. I represented a guy whose car died in the middle of the freeway at 4 a.m. He put his hazard lights and called 911 for help. At the same time, an LAPD cop, heading to work around the same time in a police unmarked car, was driving around 87-92 miles per hour. Per hour deconstructionist. He doesn't see our guy, strikes him and causes a major 6-car collision, including overturning an 18-wheeler truck. Police arrive and take photos. LAPD officer claimed our guy did not have his hazard lights on and he was only driving 60 miles per hour. He was trying to put some of the fault on our guy. At the deposition of the investigating officer, she doesn't remember if our guy's hazard lights were on or not. Attorney bring photos from the scene. One of the photos showed my guy's hazard lights on. We were dismissed shortly thereafter. Not so much a gotcha as it is a defendant giving themselves up. When I worked for insurance defense, I handled a fraud case where a man reported his Rolex as being stolen. He was adamant that he was at a hotel and it was stolen. He has shown no proof of being in a hotel, so it's flagged. We go through the whole process and finally reached depositions. He gets sworn in and eventually let out that he wasn't at a hotel but rather with his mistress and he had left it at her house. His wife noticed he didn't have it on, so he immediately claims it must have been stolen, etc. etc. This man decided to hire an attorney and go through this whole circus just so his wife wouldn't find out about his affair. Needless to say, the claim was denied. Not a lawyer, but when I was in the military I was accused of something I didn't do, and I had to go to court over it. And during court the prosecutor started to detail this investigation and how they had staked my apartment out for months. They entered into evidence a picture of my apartment, and when they put it up I looked shocked at my lawyer BC. It wasn't a picture of my place. It was my ex-wife's apartment, a place I had never lived, never even spent a single night there. I lived in a house, she lived in an apartment, and when my lawyer was asked if she objected to the picture being entered into evidence, she replied, "I don't mind them entering it into evidence as long as they change the listing of it." And when one of the members of the panel, no judge, 3-member board, asked what was wrong with the listing, she looked at him and said, "That's not his apartment." On top of this, the witness they used against me described going to my house on the night in question, and she named the subdivision where she had visited me, except that wasn't where I lived either, also wasn't where the picture they had was either. The case was dismissed and I was told they requested the witness to return to answer questions about perjury. Enol. I lived with a guy when we were in our early 20s. He worked for one of those crappy furniture rental places where people without money get furniture. Much of his job was repossessing furniture, and in his spare time he was a skateboarder. He severely hurt his back on the job and they were contesting paying his bills and settling. At one of his mediation dates, they revealed they had hired a private investigator to follow him. They showed him pictures of himself at a skate park skating when he was supposed to be home recovering. They asked him to verify it was him. He said no. These defuses had somehow missed that he had a twin brother that also skated. They eventually settled for what I thought was a very low 70k. He had back pain for years that caused him to gain weight and suffer. In his 30s he finally had back surgery and he regretted not doing it 10 years earlier. He said it completely alleviated the pain. Had a client accused of leading the cops on a high-speed chase. The cop on the stand estimated he was going 90 miles per hour, but never actually clocked him. Then the cop identified where the chase started with me, and where it ended. It lasted about 2 miles. Then we went through his log of when it started and when it ended. About 3.5 minutes. Once you walk through the math on that, the average speed of this chase was 35 miles per hour. Client got acquitted really quickly after that. The first case I ever did. Opposing counsel misplaced the copy of my client's driver's license. Rather than admitting his mistake and asking me to resend it, he filed a motion to compel, claiming we never sent it. Well, I was able to provide proof that we'd sent it to him like 8 months ago, so the judge was rather displeased with his antics. Represented a DUI client who swore up and down to me he hadn't been drinking or doing any drugs. Newbie officer who had his field training officer with him in the car. Rookie pulls client over for a tag violation. Walks back to the car with body camera still on. Training officer says get him out for a DUI and the rookie says but he's not intoxicated, to which the reply was do it anyway. Body cam clicks off. Turns on 7 minutes later and they're doing field sobriety exercises on my client. Client sat in custody for 3 weeks until I finally got the tape from the prosecutor and presented it to the judge. The oh crap looks from the prosecutor and FTO when the judge saw the tape. I'll treasure that one. The judge wrote the police chief a letter saying the FTO was dead to him and he'd deny every search warrant he tried to bring thereafter for being a liar. The client is hopefully still on track with his civil attorney in a lawsuit. I love body cams, so very much. I was suing a landlord who failed to make serious repairs in order to force the tenant out. The hard part is proving bad intent instead of mere idiocy so you get higher damages. Code enforcement was involved, so I request those records. The landlord left a voicemail to the enforcement department saying to hold off on the fines. They will make the repairs as soon as the tenant is forced out. That was an easy case. My brother is an attorney. He had a case where the guy said he was permanently disabled from a work accident. At a deposition, my brother overheard the guy talking about getting his house remodeled. He was already spending the money he thought he was getting. My brother drove by the house to see how much work was being done and saw the guy carrying bundles of roofing shingles up a ladder to the roof. This was before smartphones, so he drove to a Best Buy and bought a video camera. Went back and recorded the guy. He had copies made and sent to the other attorney. The guy dropped the suit and was back at work the following Monday. My brother's client didn't want to pay for the video camera. He saved them thousands of dollars. They eventually paid, but he still gets a little peeved when he talks about it. Not a lawyer but a legal videographer. This gentleman was claiming injuries, seeking damages against his employer after a fall at work. He claimed he couldn't raise his right arm above his shoulder because of the fall. First deposition comes along and I am hired by defendant's attorney to videotape deposition of the plaintiff. Anyone know the first thing a court reporter asks you to do in a deposition? Please raise your right hand and repeat after me. Plaintiff raises his right arm above his shoulder with ease and no sign of discomfort. Does not occur to him what he has just done. Both attorneys were looking down at their notes when this happened and neither of them caught it. The plaintiff himself didn't catch it. The court reporter looked at him and then looked at me and her eyes went wide with realization at what just happened. 4 hours of deposition proceed wherein the plaintiff is instructed, multiple times, to show his range of motion and proceeds to pretend like he can't raise his arm above shoulder level, which he did at the very beginning of his deposition. Deposition ends. Plaintiff's counsel leaves. I call defense. Hiring party. Counsel over and show him the first 2 minutes of tape. Counsel excitedly whispers to me, case closed. You just saved us tens of thousands of dollars. I got a $5,000 bonus and plaintiff's case was dismissed with prejudice. I had client whose 60k car was ruined by a shop that put in the wrong oil. We couldn't prove it at first. The engine blew up, oil leaked out and evidence was lost. I subpoenaed their bank records, figured out they bought their oil from Costco, called Costco and got their prices for the last 2 years. I then worked out the amounts they were spending, did some backhand math, and showed based on the values it was impossible they had ever bought the right oil. They settled in full immediately. You gotta admit, it is the most satisfying thing when the opposition caves in immediately when you prove what they are saying is impossible. Not as exciting in the moment as some other ones here, but we hired a private investigator to track our defendant in a fraud asset recovery case. A private investigator returned with a photograph of torn pieces of paper that clearly constituted a ripped up note, albeit in a foreign language. I happened to know said foreign language, so pieced it together and realized it was a letter written by the defendant raging at his accomplice for making highly specific mistakes that fricked him over in the context of our fraud asset recovery case. Obviously, we later had this verified and sworn to via affidavit by an official translator. It was unbelievable. The handwriting was a match. Plus, he'd also signed it, and the contents were so specific. Contained information about specific amounts going into specific trusts under specific names, that it was basically a smoking gun. We almost thought they'd planted it to throw us off, but the guy was just stupid and arrogant. Ran into a bit of a fight, Ray. Admissibility, but the letter ultimately helped us receive a significant settlement that made our clients extremely happy. This is so petty. I've had much bigger moments, but because of the character of the other side, this will always be my favorite. Doing a boundary dispute, a squabble over what was essentially a few inches of land. OS was a lawyer and an absoluter. He was acting for himself. The whole "a lawyer who acts for himself is a fool for a client" thing was bang on for him. But he was a deeply unpleasant guy, a bully who thought that he was the smartest guy in the room. Part of his case hinged on wheelie bins and how prior to the boundary having been moved there wasn't space to store a full-size bin beside the house. The fact you now could meant clearly the boundary must have moved. That was the extent of his evidence. It really was thin stuff. During the actual trial he pulled a fast one by suddenly producing an old aerial photo ostensibly to show the boundary at the front of the property had also moved. A fast one because you have to disclose stuff like that in advance. You can't just sit on something relevant and then suddenly whip it out at trial with a flourish. Whilst he was making his submissions that it should be admissible, I looked more closely at it. Away from the bit of the boundary he said it was relevant to and realized that it very clearly showed a wheelie bin in exactly the spot his case said there couldn't be one. Told the judge we were happy for the photo be admitted after all, got the other side to confirm the date it was taken, then pointed out he'd just completely fricked his case. That photo did him for nearly 50k in adverse costs. Couldn't happen to a more deserving chapter. Score 1 for wheelie bins. You have been visited by the ingenious Joe. Comment brain so you always see the glass half full. If you are new to the channel, you can subscribe. I publish new videos every day. Until then, check another video. Or don't. Either way, have a great day, you magnificent people.